Greetings and welcome. Thank you for joining us. We are about to have a very heavy, spoiler-filled conversation about Picard Episode 2, but be warned, spoilers are inbound, so if you don't want to know what's coming up in this show, now's the time to head on out because we're about to get into it. Once again, Episode 2, inching us a little bit forward, a little bit as we go in terms of story. Lots of plot exposition going on here. So let's go ahead and tease our topics really quickly. Number one, the Borg cube. What's going on with the Borg cube? Number two, what's Picard's mission? Number three, what are those Romulans up to? So we're going to get through all of that. Stick with us. And if you don't mind, as we're kind of bouncing this stuff off of each other, we want to know what you think as well. So keep those comments coming down below. So joining me today, executive editor Scott Collura, Jim Vejvoda, and my boss, head of video,
Corrado Caretto.
The theory king, Corrado Caretto. Guys, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Let's get right into it and start talking about the Borg cube. Episode one ended on the Borg cube, surrounded by Romulans. Well, this is a new situation. Scott, what was your read on this? What do we learn in episode two about this?
Well, I'm kind of trying to figure out what we learned in episode two about the Borg cube. It seems that the Romulans have some kind of a deal going where there's technology being removed from the Borg.
It's all under the umbrella of this grand research project,
right?
But it does seem like, okay, there's tech and there's weapons. Are the Romulans assimilating the Borg?
Right. Yeah. Mm. Right.
Is that what's happening? First of all, did anybody
Wait,
notice?
We got a new theory king over here.
There can be only one.
There can only be one. I just came up with that as in the moment. But what, Jim? What was your read on that? What do we learn about the situation?
Well, one, it was it took you a kind of a moment to adjust to the fact that this wasn't as insidious as that last shot of episode one.
Or was it?
We've been taught to feel that way when we see a Borg cube, right?
You start seeing, it felt like they were just simply kind of like squatters in somebody else's house. Or like, it gets even weirder where I'm like, is this sort
it's
of
worse,
like
they're looters.
Plymouth Plantation of science fiction where it's like, we're just kind of reenacting what this would have been like. But, there was a lot of funny little things in there, like the sign and everything, like 5,000 days since
without assimilation.
Yes. Yeah, that was fun. But
That got me.
But I think that it set up more questions than answers, which is fair. It's only episode two, but it was a little confusing given the setup given at the end of episode
one. Agreed. Corrado, what do you think is going on with the cube?
Well, if you guys deferred to the last conversation that we had, I did mention that one of my theories was that they may have been, in fact, detached from the collective. So we do see here that, we are dealing with a single Borg cube that is no longer part of the collective, and that they have figured out a way to sort of section off and, it does seem to be that they're doing some mining for tech as well as some rehabilitation. And I think, in this episode, it's like a research facility, they say, right?
Right.
Which, to me, right away says, this is absolutely not for that. This is more for, there is an insidious something at play here. I don't trust the Romulans.
Well, it must be tied in with, the sense stuff. But it does have that sort of quarantine and rehabilitation vibe going on, too. So it seems like there is some sort of less malignant motive for at least some of them.
On the surface.
Definitely. Soji seems to have good intentions, right? Yeah.
Soji being Dr. Asha, who is the other daughter of Data, right? And that's what she's doing there.
Yeah, she seems to be wanting to help rehabilitate these people who were Borg, right?
Yeah, and I think I think both are going to turn out to be true. I think that, my guess is, now that we're going to be seeing Hugh and we're going to be seeing Seven of Nine, my guess is that they're in it to actually save these, formally assimilated Borg. But I think that there's probably something deeper at play.
Yeah, I do get that read as well, that Soji, Dr. Asha, Data's other daughter, is there on an altruistic mission. Mm-hmm. She wants to help the Borg, the surviving drones that are now disconnected from the collective.
Yeah.
But as you said, when in these things, whenever research is thrown out, it's like, oh yeah, something dirty is going on behind the scenes there.
And she's getting played, obviously.
For sure. Yeah. She's getting played by, we'll talk about that in the moment, the Romulans, but we'll get to that in a second. Changing gears really quickly, our second topic, Picard's mission. In this episode, we start to finally get the kind of parameters. Okay, what is going to drive Picard to go back into space? We now know why he left space to begin with. Now we're starting to learn why he's going to go back. What did you think about that, Scott? Like, what the way that they set that up? How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I'm so he needs to go find. He knows where the twin is, Soji. He knows she's out.
Kind of.
She knows. He knows she's off world.
Right.
Right. So he needs to find a ship, and Starfleet isn't working with him.
Not hearing it.
Right, and they're not happy with the speech he made in episode one on TV for, I guess, the United Federation News Network or whatever it is.
It's kind of tough to, like, badmouth an organization. They'd be like, hey, can you give me a starship?
Can I have a ship and a crew? Just
please?
A small crew, you know?
Yeah.
So, and I thought that was fun, seeing him kind of be taken down a peg.
Yeah. Jim, what was your thought on the mission, on the way that they set up why he needs to go back?
Well, again, like, I'm such an old school Trek fan and fan of those old movies. Like, it had vibes of Star Trek III and, like, Genesis and, like, McCoy's trying to get a ship and then Kirk goes to, like, Starfleet to get help and they're like, Jim, that's the Enterprise is 15 years old and it gives you that. And it's like the same beat. So it's like, okay, they're kind of mining from the past and trying to give him a Kirk-like mission to go, like, rogue. But I don't know. I think it's what is kind of his plan? He's just going to get the ship and then what? Just wander in space? If somebody's like, they're out in the ocean. Which one? I don't know. What are you, just going to get in a boat and just sail around?
Oh, he's Picard.
He is Picard. You know, he's no stranger to seeking out new worlds and new civilizations.
That's true.
If you take my meaning. But we do know that he also has a time constraint. There's now a ticking clock.
Yeah, I really, really like that this is his final voyage. I guess if we're going to do
one last
season two.
But there was one moment in that show where he's like kind of looking out to the stars. I think that there's something also to be said for like Patrick Stewart himself in that moment, looking up and going, this is it. Yeah. This is my final voyage. And when they're like, and the doctor's like, are you sure? Like,
knowing everything, you want to go back out into the cold? Yeah. What does he say?
What does he say?
He says he's like more than ever now knowing everything.
And I will say this, like the few things that the show is doing well, there are those really strong, I think Stewart is at his strongest in those moments where he's like fully 100% committed and has that full on conviction of like, this is, yes, you know, and there are a couple of those moments. I love that part of this show more than anything else. I love that staring off into space knowing that this was the last mission.
And for right now, he vocalizes this several times where he feels like he owes something to Data.
Yeah.
And he talks about, this is the man whose death 20 years ago has haunted me, and now I have a chance to make this right. That's what's going to drive me back out into space. Mm-hmm. I was totally on board for all of that, but of course he needs a ship. Mm-hmm. He needs a crew. We don't have that. We got to figure out how all that goes on. Hopefully in episode 3, we'll get to that. Really quickly, going on to topic number 3, what are those Romulans up to? So it's not nothing. Picard visits Starfleet, asks for a starship, is rebuffed.
Yeah.
Right? Then directly after that conversation, that admiral then goes and talks to Commodore O, who we understand, she's a Vulcan, and she is in charge of security for all of Starfleet. And she's like, if there was some kind of secret Romulan plot going on, I would know about it. So as soon as that call ends, she goes and talks to a secret Romulan agent.
So she does know about it.
She knows something, but it's not clear if she knows that Peyton List's character is a secret Romulan or not.
Rizzo, right? That's
right, Rizzo. Her ears are covered. We know she's not necessarily showing out like that she's a Romulan. I think that would probably be a bad look around Starfleet these days.
Yeah, she's undercover.
That's a reverse Captain Kirk of the old show when they went undercover and he got the ears and the eyebrows and everything.
Well, Picard did it as well, actually, on Romulus and Data. Yeah, they
Data too.
Well-trodden ground here in terms of fake Vulcan ears and such. But like clearly, the Romulans are up to something. Yeah. Jim, what is it? What do you think?
There's clearly, they are a civilization now that is scattered. And they are a civilization that is kind of been on the ropes for a while. They clearly see something that is a threat to their remaining way of life. What that is becoming clearer, but there's clearly something there, and it must be an ancient thing because they seem to have known of something for a very long time.
Sure.
And right now, the villains have all the answers and the good guys don't know anything.
I do think that we are going to see that there is, in fact, like a militant, like sort of secret police version of the Romulans. I think that's very in line with who the Romulans always have been, that like there are the refugees in the show that we're definitely like sympathetic towards. I think like we're going to see the other half like probably pretty soon. But I also still think, I still believe that the real villains are going to end up to be, at least if not Starfleet, is going to end up to be at least a faction of Starfleet. And what we might find is that the secret police is not just the Romulans, but it's now like a faction within Starfleet as well.
The connection with Commodore O and whatever she right. knows lends a lot of credence to that.
Right, theory. And mark my words, you guys, I think that we're going to find out that the Romulans and that, like, some faction of Starfleet are in on this whole thing
together. Do you think that they had anything to do with the android attack that we saw at the...
Perfect segue. We're going to move into the final thoughts. Let's talk about the synth attack real quick. But what did you think?
Yeah. Well, that was maybe the best scene in the episode for me.
The opening scene.
It opens with the...
It was the only action scene in the entire episode.
I think so, right? It's a flashback.
Which for Star Trek... TNG, yeah. Not bad.
Not bad.
Like, let's be real. Like, remember, this is a sequel to, like, one of the most
I have more thoughts on
inactive
that.
Space shows of all time.
But for now, back to the synth attack.
Yeah, so we flash back, like, 14 years or whatever it is to the attack on Mars, and we see, like, the workers at the Utopia Planitia shipyards kind of going about their day, and they kind of have these synths around who they don't treat very nicely. So the humans aren't that sympathetic, kind of, so when they all get blown away, we're okay with it, sort of.
Hey, let me hold on a second. They weren't being super nice, but did they deserve to get obliterated?
No, they didn't. All right, take that back.
They were just busting balls.
Come on.
They
yeah, they're
busting robots.
They're making the robots say funny things at the first thing I do.
We met some of them in the short Trek, man. What's wrong with you?
Yeah.
They're people, too. They were in a music video.
I mean, come on. They're all dressed like the Tethered. From
all right. Star.
But we digress. Continue. Right.
You know which side of Starfleet I would belong to. Right?
Right. You would have a goatee.
But so at one point we see, it seems like the one synth starts to like download something. Maybe his eyes are like doing something. And all of a sudden he goes on this rampage and he kills everyone. And then we see the satellites above Mars turning around and they all start shooting at the planet. And this is the big attack that eventually, I think we learned in episode one, took 90,000 lives or something like that.
And the planet is still on fire.
Planet's still on fire. Mm. So that's what wiped out the ability, all the ships that were going to be used to carry the Romulan refugees were wiped out. So the question is, who programmed the synths to act that way?
Data was always a badass in a 90s kind of way back in the day.
Yeah.
This actually shows you like
how deadly they could be.
Terminator style, like terrifying if like one of those things went off.
The way he's working that control panel, it actually reminded me of Data. There's an episode where Data takes over the whole Dr. Soon reprograms Data to bring
to go back
and he's like,
to go back to him.
He does Picard's voice, Picard, Delta, Tango, password and stuff. But the synth was doing the same kind of moves.
Same
thing. His hands were all like weird and gross, and it was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome take. But most importantly, what do you fans think at home? Let us know what you thought of episode 2 in the comments below. And thank you for joining us. Thank you for watching. And now that you're all caught up, go ahead and check out our explainer on everything we know about the Borg. And while you're at it, go ahead and follow and subscribe to IGN wherever you'd like to watch.